What is up, everybody? Happy Monday. Good to see you. Welcome, welcome. You knocked down the music just a tad. How are you guys doing? Hope you're doing well. Good to see you. Good to see you. Vector, what is up? Yes, love to see it. I adjusted this camera height. Is this more what you're looking for? It dropped it down just a tad. So, anyway, yeah. Good to see you guys. Hope you're doing well. And we're going to go ahead and jump right in. Who is this clown? I just saw your name pop up. I didn't see the clown remark. Never mind. I do not welcome you. And I am not happy with you right now. What is up, Cal Magic? Good to see you. Welcome, welcome. And guys, we are going to be preaching on our first sign in the Gospel of John, the Wedding Cana miracle. The Wedding Cana miracle. So it's pretty important that we get these signs right because there's only seven of them in the text. And yeah, we're finally out of chapter one. We've been in chapter one for a long time. Oh, shots fired. I'm not happy to be here. Joke's on you. Ouch. What's up, Rosby? Good to see you. Welcome, welcome, Rosby. How are you? Hope you're doing well. Happy Monday. Thanks for being here. All right. So the Wedding Cana miracle, very interesting to dig into one of these signs. And this one in particular has a bunch of details about it that are intriguing. I think I wrote a paper on the Wedding Cana miracle. If not, I've definitely done some research on it, so I'm not going into it blind, and there's a lot of insight that can be found if you're willing to mine a little bit deeper into the Wedding Cana miracle. Cal Magic says, hi there, doing well, good. Son and family are moving in next month to help me with my wife and give me some alone time to de-stress and answer prayer. Praise God, Cal Magic. Wow. I know things have been tough for you, man. Hang in there. Good to see the families come to help out. That's good. That's good. Alrighty, so let's go ahead and read the Wedding Cana miracle, get our arms around it, and then we will go from there. On the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus also was invited to the wedding with his disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to his servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now, there were six stone water jars there for the Jewish rites of purification, each one holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water," and they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast." So they took it. When the master of the feast tasted the water, now become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when people have drunk freely, then the poor wine, but you have kept the good wine until now." This, the first of his signs, Jesus did at Cana in Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. After this, he went down to Capernaum with his mother and his brothers and his disciples, and they stayed there for a few days. So there's obviously a lot going on in this passage. You know, first questions that people often have are, why is he rude to his mom, right? When he says, "Woman, what does this have to do with me?" Right? Very interesting. Let's see. Amaris, I see it's time for some Greek exegesis. Man, Amaris wants me to dive in. I was doing a narrative passage. Amaris, I think I was going to avoid some exegesis, you know, like altogether. What's up, Shadeless? How you doing, my man? Good to see you. Welcome, welcome. How's life? I hope you are well. Thanks for swinging by. Cal Magic, I'm giving my California home to him, LOL. Ah, I see. Well, that is very thoughtful and generous. I'll tell you that much. Good to have you here, guys. And yeah, we're just trying to identify some of the major questions. I don't know how many times I've preached through a passage, and there are obvious questions in the text that I've already like dealt with, and I don't think they're important in my head. And then I don't treat them in the sermon, and people have questions afterwards. They're like, "Why didn't you talk about this? This is kind of a big deal." You know, so interesting to have that. So we want to just walk through and, you know, ask some of the major questions, you know, for conservatives, theologically, they're going to ask questions like, why give more wine to drunk people? You know, they're going to have issues with that. All is well. Good to hear it, Shadeless. Awesome. Amaris, yeah, same. Let me know when you gear up for some Old Testament poetry literature. I dread Hebrew. I have found Dr. Mark Futato very helpful on Hebrew poetry. Dr. Mark Futato, excellent. You did not redeem the rap, Vector. That is enough out of you. Hopefully nobody ever redeems that. Cal Magic, don't confuse miracles with magic tricks. People at the time knew the difference. Aristotle talked about magic tricks in his discourses. Ooh, that's fascinating. Go ahead and grab that idea. Bring it on over. Boop. All right. Not only that, let's see. There is a significance. I already know this. There's a significance to six jars and stone water jars used for purification. These are both important. Hello, contract. Oh, man. How can I afford to pass that up? Oops. Misclick. Amaras, do you have some tea toddlers in your congregation? My son's probably the only tea toddler I know of. Most toddlers don't like tea, but when I make tea, he asks for it and he drinks it. So, yeah, no issues there. I know what you mean, Amaras. And yes, we have some of those. I'm closer than anyone. I don't doubt it, Vector. I don't doubt it. That's okay, Vector. I've been learning. It's taken me a very long time to learn how to ban someone, but I know how to do it now. So you just saw it in execution. All right. Holding 20 or 30 gallons. Is that significant? That I don't remember. I don't remember the number of gallons. What?
S-H-A-D-E-L-E-S-S just resubbed for 7 months.
Thank you. Cal Magic, let's go. Gifted sub to Shadeless. And it's a 3-month gift. Excellent. Thank you so much, Cal Magic. Appreciate that. Appreciate you, Shadeless. Thanks for all your support over the years and hanging out with us. And yeah, I haven't really been in the Twitch scene. How are things? You know, is it there are a bunch of new Twitch streamers? Is everyone still, you know, actively in different communities? Have people kind of scattered and done their own thing? I've kind of stepped back a little bit. I just haven't had the bandwidth to keep up with people, right? Vector, I hope we never change Air Horn Button. It's too good. Hey, I'm not mad at Air Horn Button. All right, not mad at Air Horn Button at all. All right, and then let's see. It's very interesting that it's when they draw the water out that it becomes wine. I don't know if that's significant, but I'm going to put that down. He had not known where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The master of the feast called the bridegroom, said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first when people have drunk freely, then the poor wine. You've kept the good wine until now." This, the first of his signs, Jesus did. So first sign, very important. And I need to talk about signs again because they're absolutely essential to understand in the Gospel of John. Vector, is this passage proof Jesus is okay with us getting completely roasted? I don't think so, Vector. I don't think so. What is up, Angie Jags? Good to see you. How are you doing? Happy Monday. Welcome, welcome. Hope you are well here in this new year. All right. So first sign, manifested his glory. And then people believed. His disciples believed. Right? So, pretty good. New covenant, question mark. There is a covenant aspect here. Just want you to know, most commentators, we haven't had a chance to dig into them yet, but I know from previous study that most commentators believe that this passage right here, verse 6, six stone water jars used for Jewish purification rites. Right here. Six, the number of incompletion, not quite complete, and then Jewish rites of purification. These incomplete Jewish rites have now been transformed into the new wine of the new covenant, right? So there are a lot of commentators that believe that is a significant piece of what's going on here. Cal Magic says, I'm on chapter 9 of the Blue Parakeet. I can certainly see why it has its critics, but I'm really enjoying it. It asks many difficult questions that evangelical types need to address. It really makes you think. I think you would enjoy it. Well, it's on my short list now that you say that, Cal Magic. I remember you mentioned it before, that you'd been reading it, and I told you I was aware of it, but I never read it myself. So given your recommendation and the fact that I believe it is one of my primary missions in life to challenge evangelicals. It's a no-brainer. I gotta read it. Thank you, Cal Magic. Appreciate that. What is up, Gene? Great live. What camera are you using, Pastor? This is a Lumix GH5. Thanks for asking. I think they have GH6. Whoa, didn't mean to do that. F11 to exit. I think they have a GH6 these days, but I believe the 5 is just fine. So a Lumix GH5. There we go. Awesome. Yeah, thank you, Gene. I hope I said your name right. If I pronounced it incorrectly, let me know. All right, so these are just some basic ones. We're obviously going to have to treat this issue, and then our big picture thing is going to be all about what are signs. Okay, we just need to talk about signs in general. What are the purpose of signs? So sign purpose. And then we need to also talk about his rudeness. And then we need to talk about the significance, the symbolic significance. Great, you look good. Great job. Thank you so much, Gene. I appreciate that. It's taken a while to dial it in here. I'll show you the other camera. Don't like the colors on the other camera very well, but this is the other one. So this is also a GH5, but it's got a little different lens on it. And like I said, the colors, I think, on the other lens are nicer. But I like this camera too, and I like this lens as well. So yeah. That's our setup. Kind of got a two-camera setup, one here, straight ahead for looking at the big monitor when I'm working on Canvas documents and things like that. And then one up to the right where I can look while I'm working on Logos stuff. So thanks for the feedback. I appreciate it. It's taken a long time for us to dial this in. All righty. Angie Jags. Yes. Yes. Love to see it. Love to see it. Now, let's go ahead and there's a couple things I want to do here. Let's start with the passage guide and just see how we go on the passage guide. But I also want to dig into, like, not just commentaries, but I also want to dig into, like, introduction to John type stuff, because these books are going to have a treatment of what is the point of the signs, why do they matter, all that type of good stuff. And I think it's very relevant to reference that. Should be plenty. And let's go ahead and dig in. Maybe we start with some sign stuff. You know what we could do? We could probably open, like, some of Kostenberger's works. Kostenberger has good works on Introduction to John. And he's kind of well known. You know, conservative evangelical. Be good to reference. You know who'd be good to reference here? Keener. I like Keener's commentary. It's excellent. And, yeah. Keener has, I'm not sure if he surpasses Carson. He certainly surpasses him in word count. That doesn't mean he's surpassing him in value, if that makes sense. Let's open up Brunner. Let's reference some commentaries I haven't referenced in a while here. Brunner looks good. Let's try the Keener Bible background. See what he says about this section. Written to be heard. That's generally about the Gospels. The writings of John. This is one of Kostenberger's. Let's grab that. What else? Ritterboss? Eh, don't reference him much. Let's try the Wiley Blackwell. I haven't used the Wiley Blackwells as much since they came out. Amaras, every time I see your unending list of commentaries, I die a little inside. Why should you die, Amaras? I feel like that should cause your heart to soar. Use the search, man. He's not wrong. He's not wrong. Okay. Theology
this
of
is
work.
The biggest oh, room of freaked out Whoa. Snowflakes you've ever seen in your life.
Cal Magic.
Cal
come
Magic
on.
Guy cheered. X1000. At There's Angie Jags 88. Let's get a train going.
Oh, man. Cal Magic trying to get a hype train on the on the docket. All right, let's see it. Good to see you, Cal Magic. Thank you so much. 1,000 bits. Appreciate you. Awesome. Did not have to do that. Thank you. Thank you. Really appreciate that. Let's keep looking here. St. John's.
This is
Gospel.
The biggest room.
There it is.
Of
oh, come on.
Freaked out snowflakes you've ever seen in your life.
You guys did it.
Violent Midget 300 easy. Cheered. X100.
Violent and Angie. Come on.
This is the biggest room.
Appreciate
of
you guys.
Freaked out
awesome.
Snowflakes you've ever
awesome.
Seen in your life.
Hey, thank you so
Angie
much.
Angie Jags 88 cheered. X100.
And Cal Magic is playing a matching game
this
tonight.
This is the biggest room of freaked out snowflakes
love
you've
it.
Ever seen in your life.
Cal Magic guy cheered.
What am I going to do?
X100. Match.
What am I going to do with you freaked out snowflakes? Hot
this
fire indeed.
This is the
indeed.
Biggest room of freaked out snowflakes you've
you
ever seen in your life.
That's awesome.
Cal Magic guy cheered. X100. Match.
I can't get any work done.
This is the biggest room
can't even get work
of
done.
Freaked out snowflakes you've ever seen in your life.
Oh, man.
Cal Magic
awesome.
Guy cheered. X300. Magic.
Yes. Thank you so much for all the love and support. You guys are insane. You don't have to do that. You guys know that, but I appreciate you. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. God bless. God bless. You guys are the best supporters ever. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Awesome. Well, look, we've got a great start here. And let's go back to our notes and let's just start diving in. All right. So Frederick Bruner, this is a little bit of an older commentary, but it's kind of, it gets referenced quite a lot in the literature. Gospel of John, and I guess not that old, 2012, but you know, relative to some of the more recent scholarship, he was kind of first to kick some of it off, right? And I've enjoyed his commentary. So let's go ahead and see what he has to say about this entire narrative. He does take the same pericope as us, which is an encouragement, right? He takes all 12 verses. And let's just read a little bit, see what he says. One thing I would encourage you guys to do in your reading of commentaries, you do not have to read every single word in all your commentaries, okay? Sometimes they're diminishing returns and move on, all right? There's just not enough time, not enough hours in the day to study everything you would like to study. So once you get a sense of the value you're getting out of it, don't waste your time going too deep, right? So we do know we're going to want some treatment. Let's start his off right off the bat. But looking at the verses, we're very interested in verse 4. Okay. We're also very interested in verse 6 to see what those have to say. So we want to pay extra special attention to verse 4 and verse 6. Commentaries in 3.7x or die. Not going to happen, Vector. Not going to happen. Guys, Vector is making fun of the fact that at one point I humble bragged about how quickly I listen to audiobooks, and Vector never lets me live it down. So this should be your lesson in life. Do not humble brag, okay? Because you'll get called out on it, and nobody will ever let you live it down, all right? I'm just saying, never humble brag. Amaris, if you haven't read every word in every single one of your commentaries and memorized them, you clearly haven't studied hard enough. Amaris, not wrong. Not wrong. There's actually two schools of thought, kind of on the studies and, you know, commentary reading, all that type of stuff. And one school says, like, you really need to dig in and read a lot. And then I also had some professors who talked about not spending as much time on sermon prep. And that was a great encouragement to me when I realized, oh, there's some trade-offs here, and just digging all the way in is not necessarily worth it. Hey, I'm about an hour from finishing my first book for the year. Crushing it, Vector. You just reminded me. I finished one today, and I want to write it down before I forget. Where's my pen? Where is my pen? There it is. And I finished that book I recommended you read, Vector. I finished it today. It's called Make It Stick. Make It Stick. And it's about learning and how to ensure that in learning, using, you know, modern neuroscientific insights, how to ensure that what you learn, you actually retain. That's what it's about. So, yeah, I enjoyed that one. Just finished it. Today, and let me write this one down. Nice. It's stuck. That's great. Let's see. Oh, wait. You guys are going fast. All right. Amaris, I agree with that, especially knowing, too, that some passages are harder than others. That's exactly right. And so you need to have, like, kind of a variable approach, I think. If you're going to be stewarding your time well, I think you need to have a sort of variable approach to, you know, what you're focusing on your reading. So let's see. I got Make It Stick, Peter Brown. And that's my second book of the year. Peter Brown, Henry Rodiger. Guys, I keep track of all the books I read throughout the year. And I, last year, did 116 books. 116. I made a goal this year to do 150. We'll see if I can pull it off. It's an aggressive goal. But if you don't set aggressive goals, then how are you ever going to achieve them? All right? Come on now. Aggressive goals. So, yep, finished my second book of the year today. And then I have another one I'm almost done with. I'll probably finish it this week. All right. Yeah, that's awesome, Vector. So Vector's not, you know, self-proclaimed, I think, Vector. You're not much of a reader, right? Like, it's not something you spend a lot of time doing. But you start one mid-December, finish it within a month. That's pretty powerful. Well done. Well done. All right. Vector. That's messed up. You hate reading. Yeah, and that's what I thought. I thought that was your take. Let's see. Cal Magic. I stumbled on Understanding the Bible commentary series. The editor stated it wasn't directed to the scholar or pastor. Still, it seemed to have something to contribute. Thoughts? I like that series. Understanding the Bible. Let's look at their entry for our passage here. And let's see if they have John. Yes, I like this series. I've referenced this series multiple times, actually. And I think it's good. So let's see. These are additional notes, so it's not the commentary. Let's scoot a little bit higher. You can see they're a little easier to read, you know, and I've always liked this series. I think it's a good series, Cal Magic. Yeah, very nice. Vector, the book I listened to was Never Split the Difference, a book on negotiating reviews coming up. Nice. Very cool. Never Split the Difference. I don't think I've heard of that one. So let's go ahead and read what Understanding the Bible has to say here. Be a nice intro commentary, and then we can get back into Dale Bruner, okay? The journey home to Galilee is not described. The writer focuses instead on a single incident that took place after the group arrived. Debates about whether one could reach Galilee from Bethany in 2 days are pointless. First, because the exact location of Bethany is unknown, and second, because the phrase on the third day could sometimes be used to express a short indefinite period of time, like a couple of days in colloquial English. Strictly speaking, the phrase means the day after tomorrow, that is the third day after Jesus met Nathanael. This would be day six, but the gospel writer may not be speaking strictly, and in any case, the number he has assigned to this day is not six, but three. He is surely more precise here than in verse 12, a few days, and there's nothing wrong in counting a six-day sequence. But the emphasis is on the sequence, not on the total of six. If there were more days or fewer, the point would be much the same. Interpretations that speak of the sequence as 6 days of the new creation corresponding to the six-day week of Genesis 1 are questionable. So he's not a fan of like that overt symbolism that some commentators read into here. Vector says, book from a former FBI hostage negotiator. He says in the book he was one of the best, but I've never verified. Oh, wow. That's pretty cool. Yeah. It's really neat to read authors who aren't really authors first. They, like, did a profession and became, like, one of the best in the profession. And then, like, the capstone to their life or their career is to write a single book about, you know, becoming the best, right? I think that's really neat. You get a lot of people these days who want to write many books because, as a profession, they're trying to be an author. You know, to me, that's way different. So, yeah, very neat. That's awesome. I bet it was interesting. I find books like that fascinating. So, very cool. All right. So, I want to take this. And who's the author of this one? Understanding the Bible by Ramsey Michaels. Okay. So we'll grab this. he's opposed to this over-symbolizing of the passage, which is fine. Nor is it likely the sequence is intended to correspond to the 6 days of the Passover near the end of Jesus' ministry, or the 6 days prior to his transfiguration. More to the point is the observation that the third day recalls language of Jesus' resurrection from the dead, as the miracle at Cana anticipates the glory of that event. Yet this is speculative at best. The third day is not used explicitly of Jesus' resurrection in John's gospel. So, he's taking shots. To expect it to carry that connotation here, where it is part of a larger sequence, probably attributes too much ingenuity to the writer and too much sophistication to his readers. The story unfolds quickly. A marriage took place in Cana. Jesus' mother Mary, who is not named in this gospel, was among the invited guests. Probably because of her, Jesus and his disciples were invited as well. The gospel writer assumes that she attributes to Jesus supernatural power, for when the wine gives out, she speaks to him as if he can do something about it. What's up, Poncho? Good to see you. How have you been? Welcome. Good evening. God blessings. Yes, to you also. To you also, Poncho. Thank you so much for all your love and support. Good to see you. I hope you're well. Vector says, meh, with my level of skepticism, it's hard to buy into all the things he said. Ah, I understand what you mean, Vector. And hey, I actually preached yesterday on the value of skepticism because Nathaniel, in the passage right before this, is skeptical of Jesus, and Jesus doesn't criticize him about it. Jesus actually affirms Nathaniel, and even though Nathaniel is skeptical. So I think there's some value to that. Yeah, very cool. All right. His answer confirms the notion her remark was an implied request. Why do you involve me? Jesus replied, my time has not yet come. Undeterred by his apparent refusal, Mary takes him at his word and leaves the matter in his hands. Jesus proceeds to have 6 huge ceremonial jars filled with water, well over 100 gallons in all, and when the water is drawn out, is found to have changed into wine. The actual transformation is hardly mentioned at all, being relegated to a participle in Greek, a subordinate clause in English. I mean, look at these details, right? The participle, the subordinate clause, all that type of stuff. You know, we started looking at this one because Cal Magic asked my thoughts on this. These are good insights, especially for a commentary that reads so easily. You see what I mean? Like, it's not overly laden with a lot of academic references and things like that. It's very easy to read, and yet you're getting academic level insight, which is pretty nice to have. Vector says, how would Mary know of Jesus' supernatural powers? Why would she treat him like some common magician versus the Messiah? Very good question. Let's go ahead and put this over here. We're asking a bunch of questions of the text, and Vector has a good one there. So, and this goes to Cal Magic's point earlier that there's a difference in the Bible and culture and society between magic and miracles, and people know the difference. So, very interesting. Okay, let's keep going here. The greatness of the miracle is attested unwittingly by a humorous comment made from the man in charge of the feast. See, that's humorous too. I actually had somebody yesterday ask about humor in the Bible. And I said, the Gospel of John has humor all over it. It's a perfect example, right? Here's a perfect example. The incident can be viewed either in itself or as a part of the Gospel as a whole. In itself, it is a curious account of a rather extravagant miracle performed not to meet a desperate human need, but simply to avert a social disaster. It is told soberly and simply as a true incident, yet it is richly symbolic in overtones that probably account for its inclusion. Though the story proper is framed by references to Jesus' disciples, the disciples have no role in the actual account of the miracle. They serve instead to fix the story in its present context in John's Gospel. The disciples' response is what gives the story significance within that larger context. This, the first of his miraculous signs, Jesus performed at Cana in Galilee. He thus revealed his glory, and his disciples put their faith in him. I like this statement about the symbolic overtones. Vector, oh, I love the humor in the story in Kings about building the altar to Baal. Are you talking about the Baal altar that falls over all the time in front of the Ark of the Covenant? That's interesting. All right. This, the first of his miraculous signs, Jesus performed at Cana in Galilee. He thus revealed his glory. For the narrator, the disciples' place within the story proper is taken by the servants to whom Mary said, do whatever he tells you, and who alone, we are told, knew where the good wine had come from. In a sense, these servants represent not only the first four disciples, but everyone who knows where Jesus comes from and does what he commands. As soon as the miracle story has been told, attention centers on the disciples and their response. The purpose of the miracles is to reveal Jesus' glory to them, the new Israel, bringing to realization the vision promised to Nathanael. The explicit statement that they believed in Jesus completes their call and marks an auspicious beginning to the Galilean ministry. No, where they call down fire. Oh, you mean how sarcastic Elijah is and how biting he is with many of his comments? Don't get me wrong, I like that too. But it's a different kind of humor. After the single miracle in Cana and short day at Capernaum, Jesus will go to Jerusalem at the season of the Passover and drive the money changers from the temple. Yeah, that's what's going to happen next. And it's interesting that this happens at the beginning of the Gospel of John, because in the synoptics, Jesus driving out the money changers happens at the end, right before the Passover. Some say he's done it twice. Most commentators that I'm in agreement with would say that this is John taking, if you will, liberties with his placement of the event, because he doesn't care about chronology as much. Gotta skip this song, y'all. Whoa. Okay, much more better. Woo. Vector says, Baal wouldn't light the altar, and Elijah, I think, was mocking Baal, saying something like, oh yeah, I got you. Typo's killing the jokes. No, you're exactly right. Elijah is very biting and sarcastic in that encounter. Cow magic. What was the first magic trick in the Bible? Noah made a dove appear. Why didn't Noah play cards? He was sitting on the deck. Cow magic. Magician dad jokes might be the best dad jokes there are. That's awesome. That's great. Amara says, I actually argued that the whipping in the temple does happen twice, or possibly more times, recently in Matthew 21. Oh, that's interesting, Amara. I read several commentators, and I think it only happened once. But I can understand your point. Very interesting. Cool, let's keep going. We're almost done here with the Understanding the Bible commentary. Alrighty. To a reader familiar with the other Gospels, it appears that Jesus' passion is already underway. The impression given is that Gospel of John is to be a short gospel indeed. The impression is, of course, misleading because Jesus' activities continue with several journeys back and forth between Jerusalem and Galilee. Not until chapter 12 does he come to Jerusalem for the last time, and not until chapter 18 is he placed under arrest. In chapter 2, he tells his mother his time has not yet come. Yet the early placement of the temple cleansing is deliberate, and its effect is twofold. First, it puts everything that follows under the shadow of Jesus' impending passion and gives his dialogues with the Jews the character of a trial. Second, it makes the story of the Cana wedding a kind of epitome or scale model of Jesus' entire Galilean ministry, which he turns the water of traditional ritual cleansing into the wine of new and joyous messianic age. Yeah, very important. So he's okay with the symbolism of the water and the wine when it comes to Old and New Covenant. But he just doesn't like the number symbolism, which is fair. That song was about to get too big, you could tell. Okay, Jesus' ministry is seen much in the same way here as in certain synoptic parables. When asked why his disciples did not fast, he once returned, how can the guests of the bridegroom fast when he is with them? They cannot, as long as they have him with them. Jesus was not, of course, the bridegroom of the Cana wedding, yet in the imaginative world of his parables, he saw himself as the bridegroom and his time on earth as a joyful wedding celebration. He also spoke significantly of new wine, which he said must be poured into new wineskins. I think that's actually a relevant cross-reference. Let's go ahead and grab that for a cross-reference here. Oh, that's not the cross-reference, that's the full passage. But I'm not mad about it. I haven't pasted the full passage yet. I was just aiming for this. That one. Perfect. Mark 2:22. A sense of already but not yet pervades the narrative. Jesus displays his glory and his disciples come to faith, but only after a clear signal to the reader that this revelation is provisional and not final. The proper time for Jesus' glorification is at his death, and his time has not yet come. The miracle at Cana is a display of glory ahead of time, a display that typifies his Galilean ministry as a whole and specifically his promise to Nathanael. The juxtaposition of 1:19-51 and 2:1-11 in the text of John's Gospel allows each to interpret the other. Jesus is now revealed to Israel, but if Cana narrative is the end of something, that is, the six-day sequence with its promise of glory, it is also a beginning. The first of his miraculous signs indicates more will follow. More miracles do follow, but the Gospel writer has in mind one in particular, the healing of the government's official son at the same Cana in Galilee. Much has been written about a miracle or sign source used by the author of this gospel, but the numbering of Jesus' miracles stops at two. The two Cana miracles form a pair distinct from all the rest. Neither of them gives rise to discourse or controversy. Both do exactly what the gospel writer wants the miracles to do. They lead people to believe in Jesus through faith in him to gain life. Now, this is interesting because I talked briefly about miracles yesterday, and it makes me wonder if I want to address it again in this one. Maybe, maybe not. The length of Jesus' stay in Capernaum with his mother and brothers and his disciples cannot be determined from the text. The vagueness of a few days stands in marked contrast to the deliberate sequence of days extending from 1:29 to 2:11. Verse 12 represents a momentary pause, brief respite in the action before Jesus' first confrontation with Jerusalem in the temple. Other such pauses take place in Bethany, east of the Jordan, in a town called Ephraim, near the desert. Jesus said to his mother, "My time has not yet come," and now it appears they are simply waiting. Oh, he's got a translation of verse 4, and he's got some interesting comments in verse 6. So let's see what he has to say to each of those, because again, we wanted to focus on verses 4 and 6. Verse 4, "Why do you involve me?" literally translated, "What to me and to you?" A slightly more literal translation suitable to the present context is, "What do you want from me?" The idiom is used both in Hebrew and Greek literature to disassociate the speaker from the listener. For example, the demons crying out at Jesus in Mark 1:24 and 5:7. Jesus is insisting that if he acts, it must be of his own initiative in obedience to his Father. His hand will not be forced, even by a close relative. He addresses his mother as woman, a term which in Greek carries no disrespect, yet which disassociates Jesus from the traditional mother-son relationship and places him solely under God's directive. I've heard this before, that his choice of terminology is deliberate because he wants to keep proper distance. It's not rude, but it's not as warm as you might expect in a mother-son relationship. The NIV's "dear woman" is too intimate. Either "woman alone" or "my dear woman" would have conveyed better the intended note of mild annoyance. That's pretty funny. From 20 to 30 gallons, literally 2 or 3 measures. A measure was about 9 gallons, yielding an approximation of 20 or 25 gallons for each jar. Looks like he's dealing with a comment from Westcott. And this is one of the important things about signs. So I need to bring this up. Signs are miracles with a theological point to them. See Ramsey. Michaels. Yeah, I think there's value in that because people are going to forget what was the important thing about signs. And we've also got an answer now for why was he rude to his mom? And the answer is he's not quite rude, but he's not friendly either. something in between. So there you go. That was understanding the Bible commentary. And I thought it was very good. I like that set, right? Let's go to a short one next. This should be short. Yeah, it's a background commentary. Doesn't have everything, but it's got a decent chunk. So this is from Keener. Keener's written a much larger two-volume commentary on the Gospel of John, but this is just his background commentary, so he'll probably be highlighting some unique pieces here. Bible background commentary, Keener. Boom. Boom. Alrighty. Third day here does not refer to the third day of the week because virgins were married on the fourth day and widows on the fifth. Nor does it mean, does it seem to fit the count of days in 129, 35, and 43. Presumably it simply means, as it normally did, the third day after the event just narrated, counting the days inclusively, so that it was the day after the next. But ancient writers often bracketed off segments of their work by starting and ending on the same note, a practice called an inclusio. Thus, John may use this designation to point towards 219 and link this story with the prediction of Jesus' death and resurrection. Cana may be Kephar Cana, over 3 miles from Nazareth, but most scholars prefer Kirbit Cana, over 8 miles from Nazareth. Either site would be a long walk, close enough to Nazareth to explain how the host knows Jesus' family. Third day is obviously a reference to the band, says Vector. Oof, no. No, that's a miss. That's a miss. Sorry to say that, Vector. Amaris, imagine your mother asking you annoying questions in public. I'm sure I've never had that experience. But if you were Jesus, how do you respond? That's the question. You're a miss. He got me, guys. He got me. There's nothing. Oh, nice. Nice. Alrighty. Let's go. I think I want this whole thing because it seems to indicate there might be some symbolic significance to the third day. So let's actually write that down in our list of notes here. We've got our symbolic significance of signs in general. Oh, I put it in the wrong spot. This goes up here. Okay. And so now let's go third day. Third day significance could be pointing to verse 19. Could be associated with 219 and the resurrection. And let's look at verse 19 to see if it says what we think it does. Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Okay, so there's a link here. And so the 3 days theme that pervades the Gospel of John, focused on the resurrection, might be what is being hinted at here on the third day. Third day. There was a wedding at Cana in Galilee. Whoa, what's going on? Vector. Goodness gracious. Cal Magic says, at my wedding, I told a friend that we were starting our honeymoon by visiting the Magic Castle. He asked if I was performing. My mother smiled and said, he'd better. Thanks, Mom. That's awesome, Cal Magic. I love it. Oh, man. Good start to the honeymoon. Amaras, man, that's a question for the ages. Was Jesus ever anointed his mother? LOL's theological quandaries abound. See, that's my point, Amaras. Exactly. You spend the whole sermon on those theological quandaries. Vector, I would love to explore and know the depths of Jesus' humanity. I actually think it's a really important New Testament concept. And I think evangelicals are so concerned to maintain the divinity of Jesus that oftentimes they do not talk about his humanity, which is a real shame, because I think his humanity is really important for us. Okay. Let's continue. Verse 2. Weddings ideally lasted 7 days. This is great background information. So, weddings, background info. See Keener. 7 days. Weddings ideally lasted 7 days, and hosts invited as many people as possible, especially distinguished guests like prominent teachers. Many guests would come for only a part of the time, however, making the requisite resources harder to predict. Ah, how much wine do you really need if a bunch of people are only stopping by? Vector says, I've never gotten a satisfying answer to the question, could Jesus have actually sinned? It's actually a theological debate amongst theologians. I'll show you. Amaris, okay, well, this is all the heresy I can take for one night. I gotta bounce. Time for kids to go to bed. Peace out. God bless. God bless you, Amaris. Take care. So, I've read about this issue in Grudem's Systematic Theology. And let's see. There's a whole section in the chapter on Christology where he talks about it. Doctrine of God, doctrine of man in the image of God, Christ, person of Christ, atonement, resurrection, ascension, offices, work. Probably person of Christ. Virgin birth, his humanity, human weakness and limitations. Sinlessness. Though the New Testament clearly affirms that Jesus was fully human just as we are, it also affirms that Jesus was different in one important respect. He was without sin. Some have objected that if Jesus did not sin, then he was not truly human, for all humans sin. Excuse me. But those making that objection simply fail to realize that human beings are now in an abnormal situation. God did not create us as sinful, but holy and righteous. Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden before they sinned were truly human. And we now, though human, do not match the pattern that God intends for us when our full sinless humanity is restored. So this is his actual sinlessness. But what about the possibility, right? And that's what you're getting at. Could Jesus have sinned? Part 4. The question is sometimes raised, was it possible for Christ to have sinned? Some people argue for the impeccability of Christ, in which the word impeccable means not able to sin. Others object that if Jesus were not able to sin, his temptations could not have been real. For how can a temptation be real if the person being tempted is not able to sin anyway? In order to answer this question, we must distinguish what Scripture clearly affirms on the one hand, and on the other hand, what is more in the nature of possible inference on our part. One, Scripture clearly affirms that Christ never actually sinned. There could be no question in our minds on that fact. Two, it is also clearly affirms that Jesus was tempted and these were real temptations. If our speculation on the question of whether or not Christ could have sinned ever leads us to say that he was not truly tempted, we have reached the wrong conclusion. And so he actually talks about it and he doesn't give a satisfying answer either, Vector. All right. Hello. Let's see. Sid, are you using the free Logos app or paying for it? Yes, I'm paying for it. Thank you, Vector, for answering. Use the Verbum version of Logos. Standard gold, yeah. So CalMagic, no, Vector uses Vector just uses Logos standard. Let's see. So he continues, and he actually lists a bunch of questions here, Vector. With this in mind, it is appropriate for us to say, one, if Jesus' human nature had existed by itself, independent of his divine nature, then it would have been a human nature just like that which God gave Adam and Eve. It would have been free from sin, but nonetheless able to sin. Therefore, if Jesus' human nature had existed by itself, there was the abstract or theoretical possibility Jesus could have sinned. 2, but Jesus' human nature has never existed apart from union with his divine nature. 3, although there were some things, such as being hungry or thirsty or weak, that Jesus experienced in his human nature alone, and were not experienced in his divine nature, nonetheless, an act of sin would have been an immoral act that would have apparently have involved the whole person of Christ. Therefore, if he had sinned, it would have involved both his human and divine natures. 4, if Jesus as a person had sinned involving both his human and divine natures, then God himself would have sinned and he would have ceased to be God. Yet that is clearly impossible because of the infinite holiness of God's nature. 5, therefore, if we are asking if he was actually possible for Jesus to have sinned, it seems we must conclude it was not possible. The union of his human and divine natures in one person would have prevented it. There you go. So that's his answer, Vector. Not saying he's right, but it's one answer. It's a debated question in theology. So you ask a good question when you throw that one out there. All right, let's go to verse 3. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." To run out of wine at a wedding was a social faux pas that could become the subject of the village's jests for years. The host was responsible to provide his guests with adequate wine even if the feast lasted 7 days. Women were often closer to where the wine and food were prepared. Thus, Mary learns of the shortage of wine before the word reaches Jesus and the other men. Her words may be a polite Middle Eastern way of implying that he should do something. Guests were to help defray the expenses of the wedding with their gifts. It seems their friend needs some extra gifts now. Also good to know about that etiquette. Vector says, yeah, that makes sense, but in that brings to question the value of the temptation. Was it like being tempted by a coconut cream pie or 3-month-old glass of milk? I understand, Vector. I do like what he says about Jesus' human nature. That if you could isolate Jesus' human nature from the divine nature and say that they weren't united, then Jesus could have sinned, right? I think that's valuable. And to me, that would say it's like being tempted by coconut cream pie, right? I know if you just lean into his divine nature, it's like, oh, you're being tempted by something that's not tempting at all. You see what I mean? And I don't think that's what happened. But trying to suss out all the details of how it works is complicated. I'm more and more getting to the point that if your systematic theology is getting in the way of just reading the text plainly, that it's your systematic theology that you kind of just got to go, eh, not sure we know this 100% or exactly, right? Vector says, to be fair, that's the best discussion I've heard about it. What I usually get is very shallow. Yeah, I understand. So I would say that it's a real temptation. My general tendency would be, without all the equivocation, I would say, yes, Jesus could have sinned. But, you know, there's all these caveats placed on that, right? But I definitely want to lean in the direction of a real temptation. Verse 4, woman was a respectful address like ma'am, but hardly customary for one's mother. Jesus' statement here establishes further polite distance. What have I to do with you is usually a harsh, not a polite expression in biblical language. One's hour could refer to the time of one's death, but Jesus' hour in John refers especially to the cross. Here Jesus is saying, once I begin doing miracles, I begin the road to the cross. Like many Old Testament seekers of God who would not take no for an answer, Mary acts in confidence that Jesus will hear her entreaty. Ancient Jewish writers who told stories of miracle workers who insisted that God would send rain would read Mary's action as demonstrating strong faith. Her words may evoke Pharaoh's similar wording concerning Joseph, a God-empowered provider. Verse 6, this is one that we wanted to reference because has to do with the fundamental symbolism in the miracle. The description of the stone jars indicate they contained enough water to fill a Jewish immersion pool used for ceremonial purification. Although Pharisees forbade storing such water in jars, and Essenes and Sadducees also avoid this, some Jews were probably less strict. Jewish people also poured water over their hands to purify them, but such jars would not have been suitable for direct pouring, though water could be drawn from them. In any case, these large jars were being reserved for ritual purposes. to employ water pots set aside for purification for non-ritual purposes violated custom. Jesus here values the host's honor above ritual purity customs. That's actually a really valuable insight. Relative value of honor versus purity and ritual customs. Very interesting. Vector says, if they weren't for water, what was supposed to go in them? No, what he means is that understanding what rituals they're for would depend on how serious these individual Jews were. So you could fill up an immersion pool with the amount of water in these jars, but would that be appropriate water for immersion, right? Which is ritual cleansing that Gentiles would go through when they came to Jerusalem for the Passover. Well, some Jews might say yes, some Jews might say no. And Keener's point is, you know, if some Jews would think that's not appropriate, well, some would probably be fine with it. So that's kind of the idea. But yes, they held water, no doubt. What's up, Masterwood? Good to see you. Been a little bit. How are you doing? Happy Monday. Poncho, I heard something earlier in reference to miracles. Cokeville miracle was a very strong insight into the reality of God's power. I don't know if I've heard this one. Poncho. I think that one's new to me. Vector says, it makes more sense to me that he couldn't, but cheapens the temptation in my mind, like I said, but that's always been the difficulty. The question is really driven by the act of the temptation. Yeah, I understand that, Vector. Makes sense to me. Okay. 7, the jars were consecrated for sacred use. Jesus shows more concern for his friend's wedding than a contemporary ritual. 8, master of the banquet, position of honor. One of the primary duties was to relegate the distribution of wine to prevent excess that would, especially in a Jewish context, ruin the party. At least in Greek banquets, guests sometimes elected this person. At other times, the host would select him or he would be chosen by lot. His role included presiding over the entertainment and controlling the level of dilution for the wine. Thus, some of the observers might have held him partly responsible for the host running out of wine prematurely. Ah, it's very interesting. Did not know that about this character. Happened in your neighborhood, Wyoming. Huh. Yeah, I've not heard of this one. I'll have to dig into it, Poncho. Cokeville miracle. Very interesting. Cal Magic, thanks for the clarification, Vectorax. Somehow I got confused, most likely due to me being 70. I love getting to use my age for mistakes. You're not wrong, though, Cal Magic, that we do have a Catholic that hangs out in chat sometimes. But to Vector's point, it is BJH13. BJH13 is our quote-unquote resident Catholic, as Vector puts it. All right, here towards the end, soon after the grape vintage, all wine would contain some alcohol. Neither refrigeration nor hermetic sealing existed, but the alcohol level of the wine was not increased artificially. Distillation was not in use. Rather, the wine was watered down, with on average 2 to 3 parts water, 1 part wine. Sometimes at Greek parties, drunkenness was induced through less dilution or the addition of herbal toxins, but Jewish teachers disapproved of such practices. That drunkenness is part of the celebration at Cana is unlikely. Yet it normally made sense to serve the better wine first because, drunk or not, guest senses would become more dulled as the 7 days of banqueting proceeded. Fascinating conclusion here. I think this is special pleading from Keener. And I think it diminishes the humor inherent in John and John's statement. He's trying to make the case that there was no drunkenness at this wedding, and I don't buy it. Man, I feel like that is just part of a more fundamentalist, you know, conservative evangelical reaction against the text. So I'm glad the case can be made. I value Keener's scholarship quite a bit, but very interesting to see him making the case here. Just seems so obvious in the text, right on the surface of the text, that that's not the case. Interesting. Verse 11, for God had often manifested his glory by doing signs. Moses' first public sign was turning water into blood. Okay, this is an important link. Ding, 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 ding. Jesus' first sign is turning water into wine. Very interesting. It's like a shadow or a type. That's right. That's right. Vector, I am dabbling with Mormonism, though. Joe Smitty is my homeboy. Oof. Oof. That's a miss, Vector. That's a miss. I actually talked to somebody recently who told me that Mormonism had a certain appeal because of their doctrine of the eternal covenant of marriage, i.e. that when you get married here, your marriage is for eternity. That's interesting. I've never heard somebody make the case that that was like an appealing idea to them. But yeah, I talked to someone recently who had said that that idea is very appealing, and they could see why people might be attracted to Mormonism because of the doctrine of eternal marriage, right? I was like, wow, that's fascinating. I've not heard somebody say, like, I've often seen Mormons defending it, but not with like a, in particular, like a strong conviction that it is the case, you know, but instead like almost as though, okay, you know, I've got to defend this idea, inconvenient, I need to figure out what to say. You know what I mean? You're a miss again. Oh, man. Vector says, I can see the appeal. It's a very earthly-minded mindset. Yeah, that's how it feels to me. Cal Magic, have you read How to Read Revelation Responsibly by Michael Gorman? Just started it, but it looks like he's taking the topic in a whole new direction. His PhD advisor is Bruce Metzger. I'm really interested. Have you read it? I have not. I've not even heard of it. I've heard of Gorman. I think I've read a book from him. I'm guessing it's a new release. No, I've got it here. Interesting. Reading Revelation Responsively. I'm going to add this to my short list. I've got a list of books to read over here. And, I put it in my of interest folder. Boom. I'll check it out. My of interest folder is loaded, though. Look at all these books. Oof. Oof, that's a lot to read, y'all. We'll get to them. Oh, actually, I finished one of them. Biblical Hermeneutics 5 Views. That one's done. That can be removed from the of interest folder. Look at that. Look, guys, you add a book, you remove a book. I don't think I've read any of these other ones, though. We'll get there. We shall get there. Cool. Thanks for the recommendation. Appreciate it. Excellent book. Ooh, very nice, Poncho. Poncho recommends it, Cal Magic. Wearsby's Exposition... 50% off right now. That's pretty good. Usually 50% off is when I start heavily looking, even if I wasn't interested in the title. Vector. I'll never live that down. All right, guys. Let's head now to the Bible Blackwell commentary on John. You guys will recall on the channel... Ooh, this is interesting. Interlude Christ and Dionysus. That's intriguing. You guys will recall on the channel, I did a critique of the Bible Blackwell commentary set, but it was only when like two of them had been out, not the full thing. And I was critical because it was an uneven set. So, to defeat your voice, it was an uneven set, and I'm really interested in the John volume. Let's see how it holds up. For Bede, he means the Venerable Bede, the early church father. For Bede, the third day signifies the dawning age of grace, which supersedes the ages of the patriarchs and the law. Augustine contends that this marriage prefigures the heavenly nuptials in which Christ himself is the groom. Eusebius, in On a Map. Neither here nor elsewhere does the evangelist name the mother of Jesus, nor does he ever speak of a human father. Hoskins rejects and Brody endorses Loisy's claim that she is a type of Israel. Yeah, I think I would reject that too. I think Jesus is the type of Israel, not her. Chrysostom suggests that the mother of Jesus and her family were invited because they were local celebrities. All the more reason, no doubt, to suspect that Sayers was right to present the disciples as uninvited guests. Stanton remarks that Mary gives instructions like a relative of the groom. Nevertheless, though the compliment at 2:10 should have been addressed to him, the inference that Christ himself was the bridegroom is a fantasy, contradicted rather than supported by the metaphorical usage of the term at 3:29. So, thus far, I'm not super pleased with Mark Edwards' treatment. And here's why. He's doing just a collection or collation of previous commentators. Very little thoughts of his own are included. Now, don't get me wrong, the Bible Blackwell commentaries are meant to take the historical usage of this book by the church and present them. But really what he's doing at this point is not like going to like major developments in biblical interpretation down through church history or anything like that. Instead, he's doing something quite similar to, something very similar to like Nicole Robinson's Sermon Outline Bible, where you can see after each section, he quotes other commentators. And it's just a collation of other commentators, right? So he'll grab an idea and he'll say, oh, here's an idea. This comes from W.F. Hook in his Sermons on the Miracles. And then here's an idea. This comes from J. Vaughan in his 50 Sermons. And this comes from E.L. Hull, his Sermons in the third series. And this comes from H. Alford, Sermons on Christian Doctrine. You see, like, it's just a collation of what previous people have said. And don't get me wrong, that can be valuable, but what I understand the Bible Blackwell commentaries to be doing, it needs to be more than this. I'm only two verses in, but it seems to me all he's doing is just collecting what historical commentators have said, right? Like if I look at a commentary like, let's see if we can find it. The Reformation Commentary on Scripture. These are very similar. Okay. Wedding at Cana, details of time and place, blah, blah, blah. This is what Wolfgang Mucullus says. This is what Philip Melanchthon says. This is what Caspar Crusager says. This is what Martin Bucer says. This is what Johannes Occam Claudius says. You see what I mean? It's like, okay, that's cool to collect all of these thoughts from older commentators. You know, the ACCS series is similar. Right, here's Chrysostom, Cyril of Alexandria, Eusebius, Theodore Mospuesta, Theodore Heraclea, on and on. But, like, I understand the Bible Blackwell commentary to be trying to do something different than this. And notice that of the ones I've referenced, watch, as we go on, it's just going to come out more and more that this is all he's really doing. He's probably gathered together, like, 20 authors that, you know, and maybe more than that, but early church fathers and things like that, and read all their stuff and just gone through, and it's like a compilation. And then he'll just say, so-and-so says this, so-and-so says that, so-and-so says this. and I want a little bit of originality in the thought. Again, this is a classical thing to do. Here's the Catena or Aria. Same idea. Chrysostom, Alcuin, Bede, Augustine, Bede, Chrysostom, you know, just a collation. So, Vectorax says money grab from other people's work. Right. And, you know, these older ones like the Catena, this was penned by Thomas Aquinas a long time ago. So, I don't think a money grab on his part. I think he sees it as a summary. But in our day and age, yeah, it certainly feels that way. Especially if with the Bible Blackwell. I just feel like it can offer a lot more. Anyway, let's continue. Codex Sinaiticus and other versions add, for the wine of the marriage was exhausted. If this was the first sign, why did Mary expect a miracle? Because, replies Romanus, she was conscious of a miracle at Christ's birth. I think that goes to your question, Vector. Why did she expect a miracle? Says she was conscious of a miracle at Christ's birth. That comes from Chrysostom. Alcuin, however, argues that her unseasonable demand for a sign typifies the impatience of the Jews. Notice that he's quoting some of the exact people we saw in the Catena, right? Like, I can almost guarantee that's what this author did, Mark Edwards. You know, and like, these Bible, Bible Blackwell commentaries, these are not cheap, okay? These are like an expensive academic theological resource. And bro just read the Catena and dropped a line in there, right? Like, could be better. Thus far, my opinion of Wiley Blackwell is not high. Verse 4. The same construction, what have I to do with thee, is used by indignant demons at the approach of Christ. And all the fathers followed Irenaeus in construing Christ's words as reprimand to Mary. I actually like that Mark 1:24 reference. I like the fact that there is a reference to his rebuke being similar to the demon's rebuke to him. In Mark 1:24. That's pretty valuable. Vectorax, it's just weird because this on the surface feels more like a cheap magic trick versus a miracle from the Messiah. Magic tricks are not cheap. I love it. Yeah, I understand, Vector. I think it's because of the symbolic significance of what he's doing, right? He has 6 stone jars full of water for Jewish purification. And Jesus in, say, Matthew will say, old wineskins cannot hold new wine, or they'll burst. Old wineskins have hardened, right? This is actually a key idea. So, I'm conflating a few ideas from the Gospels here, but I think it's really helpful. Jesus elsewhere says, old wineskins cannot hold new wine. The reason being, the new wine is still fermenting, if that makes sense. It's still expanding, the pressure's still increasing, etc. New wine is volatile. And old wineskins are hardened, they're brittle, they're set in their ways. And Jesus says, you can't put new wine into old wineskins or the old wineskins will burst, all right? This is opposed to new wineskins. New wine can go in new wineskins because the new leather is able to stretch with the increasing pressure of the new wine that is present within. And so as it stretches, it accommodates the new pressure and the new wineskins do not burst. And the new wineskins can hold the new wine. Now, Jesus is using this in a context to talk about the fact that the old covenant had what was like old wineskins. It was brittle, it was hard, and it could not hold the new wine of the new covenant and the age of Christ and the age of the Holy Spirit. So Jesus says new wineskins are needed. And that's what he essentially is teaching when he is pointing out the fact that we should follow him, right? Now, taking that idea of the old and new wineskins and now putting in the context of this miracle, you have the situation where you have these 6 stone jars and they're representative of Jewish ritual purification. And Jesus turns the old water of Jewish ritual purification into wine, the new delicious wine of the new covenant. And so I understand what you mean. Like, if you look at it historically only, then yeah, it feels like a cheap magic trick, even though magic tricks aren't cheap. But if you look at it symbolically, what you have is Jesus performing a miracle that is meant to teach something deeper and greater. And so it's perfectly fitting in the Gospel of John that he would do a miracle like this. This is actually really important in the Gospel of John. Jesus' miracles in John's Gospel are not magic tricks. They actually are kind of like that in the synoptics. If you look in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Jesus performs miracles that are much like magic tricks. They're one and done, and all they are meant to teach you is that Jesus is, you know, powerful, supernatural, whatever. But in John, every miracle is also a symbol. They're all symbolic. That's why they're called signs. They're not like traditional miracles like in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And so in John, whenever a miracle is performed, it always has a symbolic significance behind it as well. And that's the symbolic significance of this one. Okay. So it's very particular to John. This is how he writes. And he selects seven miracles from Jesus' ministry to particularly demonstrate certain truths, right? So anyway, yeah, good point. But when you understand the background of the Gospel of John and why the author writes, I think it sheds a little bit of light on the situation. All righty. Hoskins implies that Nonnus was the first Greek to deny this. Trench records that the attempts of Bernard and Maldonatus to show that Christ did not mean to dishonor the Blessed Virgin, but to prove that he was acting from humanity rather than from personal affection. For Blake, the commandment to obey thy parents is annulled here. Yet Wesley contends that Christ employs this constant appellation here and at 1926 because he regarded his father above all. The bourgeois Strauss maintains that both the acerbity of Jesus and his mother's nonchalance are incredible. Giblin sees a pattern of self-revelation through apparent inconsistency that recurs in chapters 4, 7, and 11. Isaac of Stella's paraphrase is neat. I have power in common with my father, weakness with my mother. Protestants discover an admonition not to transfer to Mary the things that belong to God. Quoting Calvin. What had she to do with you but tempt you from your father? Asks Ted Hughes. Ancient commentators were more disturbed by the Gnostic marriage of this verse with Mark 3:33 to imply that Mary was not the true mother of Christ. Oh, interesting. Context matters, huh? Again, this shows the quality of the Wiley Black, but well, don't get me wrong, he's obviously well-read. He just quoted tons of authors down through history on this verse, but that's all he did, okay? He just collected, compiled, and then regurgitated what other authors have said. Valuable in some ways, but not in others. Not what I thought the Wiley Black Bills were meant to be. Oh, interesting. Vector says, Cal Magic, true story. I was a member of the International Brotherhood of Christian Magicians. Magic or some other art? Magic. I was into close-up magic, mostly card stuff. Was big into Jeff McBride and Lance Burton. Vector, did you know Cal Magic was a magician? He actually knows. Cal Magic actually knows many magicians. Like, he's in. What's up, Ping? Good to see you. Welcome. Ping watched seven consecutive streams this month and sparked a watch stream. That's pretty cool. Thank you, Ping. Appreciate you watching, supporting. Vector's saying it like that, it sounds like John cherry-picked miracles to prove his point, a problem that plagues the modern church. I actually think you're correct, but I think what he did, here's the take I have. I think John was already familiar with Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and that John was written last. And John had no interest in just sharing all the same stuff that was in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And so he thought, I'm going to highlight some specific miracles from Jesus' ministry that aren't highlighted there. And yes, I think he cherry-picked certain specific ones in order to make a theological point. But I don't think that makes him a bad faith actor or anything like that. I just think it means he's doing something different in his gospel than we might consider in terms of a typical, like, chronological or historical account. Cool. Good discussion. All right, let's keep going. Fortness sees the remnants of poor editing in the apparent contradiction between Christ's words and his subsequent action. Hutchinson assumes that there was some delay, but Romanus avers that Christ performs the miracle before his hour out of reverence to his mother. Temple and Hoskins are among those who argue that the hour to which Christ alludes is that of his crucifixion. I will grab that, because several commentators have said that now. To one Victorian preacher, Mary exemplifies the spirit of pure womanhood, which unsensualizes coarse and common things by domestic service. Chrysostom points out that the use of servitors rendered the miracle more conspicuous and more credible. Brody, deploring Schnackenberg's neglect of the disciples, argues that the power to induce obedience is the true miracle, and Riddler concurs that the atoms did not change, but those who drank. I'm going to go already, but wanted to get the streak. 1 Corinthians 1:3. Thanks, Bing. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll see you later, Ping. Take it easy. Vector Action. Yes, they are all good friends, including Penn and Teller, Chris Angel, and others. Yeah. Pretty cool, Cal Magic. Pretty sweet career. Vector says, that's fair. It's easy to assume bad motives, but you make a good point. It would have been more helpful if they told us what their intentions were instead of having to speculate. Yeah, that's a good point. It's a good point. I mean, of all the authors, John comes the closest to telling us what his motives are. He says it later in the book. I think it's in John 21. No, it's in John 20. John explicitly tells us. I'm not able to find it right now. But he says at one point, I write these things so that you may know that Jesus is the Christ. And by believing in his name, you may be saved. Or something like that. So of all gospel authors, John is the one that comes closest to actually just explicitly telling us his motives and intention. All right, let's go ahead and finish off with the Wiley Blackwell here. And I want to read this section on Christ and Dionysius. See, this is one of the nice things about this is that I think he's going to treat this seriously. And I think many evangelical commentators wouldn't even touch this with a 10-foot pole. So let's get there. The miracle itself. Beatty derides the purification as a Pharisaic rite, like the washing of the hands in Mark 7. Chrysostom objects that wine would never have been stored in such a vessel. Isaac of Stella argues that, as the wheat contains the seventh day apart from the days of labor, so the six vessels represent the insufficiency of human striving. The two measures stand for the dual sense of Scripture, and the old wine for the wisdom of the Gentiles, which causes them to reel like drunken men. So funny that his take would be so counter to what I've seen many evangelicals talk about, which is that the water does not represent Gentiles, but actually Jewish purification. 7-8, on Hoskins' computation, the entire capacity of the vessels was between 108 and 162 gallons. Strauss, without calculating, finds the quantity extravagant and dangerous. Hilary of Poitiers compares the wine of the Eucharistic chalice, whose spiritual nature is known to the one who pours it in, but not to the one who pours it out. Hoskin follows Westcott in noting that the verb draw out anticipates 4:11 to 16. Oh, that's intriguing. Where he talks to the woman at the well and they draw out water from the well. I love the magic discussion you guys are having. I've seen... I grew up in Vegas, right? I think I saw Lance Burton on the Strip. Like, went and saw his show. I think we did it for, like, prom one year or something. And then, I never followed him, but I watched some of David Blaine's, like, you know, some of his extreme stunts that he has on, like, YouTube and stuff. Yeah, interesting. The title Architriclinios is late and rare, and passed into the vernacular as the proper name for Architriclin. Trench, however, quotes Sirach to demonstrate that the office at least was known among the Jews. Oh, this is the guy, the head, you know, head wine taster guy. Alcuin asserts that he reclined as guest in chief at the head of the couches and perhaps held the office of priest among the Jews. Hoskins suggests that his ignorance prefigures that of Nicodemus, the Samaritan woman, and Pilate. In the 15th century Gospel of Barnabas, this compliment is addressed to Christ, not only because it was he who wrought the miracle, but because he is revealed at 329 to be the groom of the elect. Romanus avers that the transmutation of water is foreshadowed by the parting of the Red Sea. That's interesting. While Trench contrasts that the conversion of the Nile by blood, of the Nile to blood by Moses, and that's one I'm fairly convinced of. To Raudolphus, the wine suggests the ardor of the converted soul. Grassi indeed suspects an allusion to Pentecost, since the Spirit is likened to water in the Gospel, and the Galilean apostles who receive it in Acts are mistaken for drunkards. I actually watched some Piff stuff the other day, Vector. He's more about, like, being a character, right? I feel like many of his magic tricks are just the same one, recycled over and over. That whole, like, trick where I have you pick a card and then, like, you know, I somehow have it embedded somewhere else. So it's in a picture, or I have it, you know, folded up and stuffed somewhere else kind of thing. But he does that same trick, but he just puts twists or flair on it, given the, you know, given his, like, goofiness and his context, right? Yeah, exactly. I do like his dry delivery. Yeah, that's interesting. The work of God, as Robertson says, took 30 years to ripen, or rather thousands. Even then, the miracles performed elusively, as Linders comments, and it is only the disciples who are conscious of a sign. Sassy rejects the opinion that the text refers only to the first sign that Christ performed in Cana, yet it is true that all the numbered signs occur in Galilee. Interesting. Okay, let's look at his interlude talking about Christ and Dionysius. And the idea here is that Dionysius is the god of wine and drunkenness and other things. And in performing the transforming of water into wine, that Christ is performing, in a sense, a Dionysian miracle. Now, I've even heard some claim that turning water to wine is not something Jesus would do, but that Dionysius would do. And that this is, like, almost wholesale borrowed from Dionysian, you know, or Bacchus cults, right? Let's see what he has to say. Incredulous readers have always been inclined to compare the miracles of Christ to those of wonder workers. And since Dionysius was the god of wine, it was inevitable that the first of the signs should have been construed as an imitation of his mysteries. Even Justin Martyr could not deny that the cults had something in common. And Wertheim furnishes half a dozen references which reveal that Dionysius was occasionally credited with the spontaneous creation of wine from water, or from nothing. None of these, however, suggest that his worshippers, except in myth, could imitate the alchemy that is here ascribed to Christ. Nor, as Trench reminds us, does the narrative condone the incipient drunkenness of the Architriclinios, let alone the intoxication that ancient texts associate with Dionysian orgies. Scholars of the early 20th century maintained that Dionysius and Christ were only two of the many dying and rising gods who populated the ancient Mediterranean. But today it seems improbable that this hypothetical category will survive the criticisms of G.Z. Smith. It is commonly held in antiquity, however, that the Yahweh of the Jews was Dionysius, and that one of the latter many names, Sabazius, was a variant of the Hebrew Yahweh Sabaoth, Lord of Hosts. An early Byzantine tragedy, Christus Pacians, Christ's Suffering, robs the Bacchae of Euripides for a third of its materials, preserving a number of verses from that Greek play that would otherwise have been lost. Another Byzantine poet, Nonnus, versified both the Johannine account of Christ and the myth of Dionysius, though without implying the two were one. Yeats assimilates the Matthean story of the Nativity to a myth in which the infant Dionysius is torn to pieces in his cradle, and Athena, the maiden goddess of wisdom, stumbles on the traces of the crime. From Yeats, I saw a staring virgin stand where holy Dionysius died and pluck the heart out of his side. The first line recalls John 20:25. The third, John 20:31. In Wol Soyinka's The Bacchae of Euripides, the god is represented by a sitting Christ, whose crown of thorns has given way to the ambiguous ivy wreath. Stibb observes that the Dionysius of tragedy, like Christ, is a god who comes to his own, and his own receive him not. In The Bacchae, however, Dionysius is a murderer, for René Girard, the antitype of Christ. Not as helpful as I wanted it to be. I'm glad he went here. I guess it will tell me this. There are significant differences that I don't think you have to conclude that there's any comparison to Dionysius being made when it comes to Jesus. All right, guys. Well, let's see. How much time have I gone? I think I need to quit here. It's going to be bedtime soon for the kids, and I need to help to put them down. Let me look. I'm at an hour and 30, so yeah, it's a good stopping point. What do you guys think of the lighting? I know I've asked this multiple times recently, but the lights are up higher than I typically put them. And again, the white balance was showing some significant overexposure in certain aspects of the picture. But if I don't look overexposed or my shirt doesn't or anything like that, then we're good. But I just want to double check and see what you guys think. CalMagic, the amazing Jonathan show in Vegas was so offensive, none of my friends would take me to see him. Sadly, he died a year back. Vector says, I liked his style, but the crude offensive nature of his humor was over the top for me. Would have enjoyed seeing other people mimic his style. Ah, interesting. Looks good. Okay, cool. Well, I appreciate that feedback. Well, excellent, guys. I think we made good progress. I identified some areas that I want to dig into that I didn't know. I liked the Tetris lights. Okay, so CalMagic likes... I've got these on a continuous color now, right now. You liked CalMagic when they were like colored blocks that dropped into place. Okay, I can mix it up for the stream. I think for recording, I like videos on YouTube... I think I like it just being a fixed color, but I can totally see your point on, you know, have something a little more dynamic and interactive while we're streaming. So cool. I'll keep that in mind. Well, I appreciate you all so much. Thanks for swinging by and hanging out. I think we made good progress. I've got some stuff to dig into, but I think we're well on our way, and we've got a lot of insights into this particular sign miracle. So pretty cool. Appreciate you all hanging out. Here, let's just check real quick. Got YouTube open. I never check Kick. I have zero viewers on Kick. I probably shouldn't waste my time, I would think. But who knows? It's free. It's free to like multi-stream to it, so I guess it's fine. But we usually get good interaction on Twitch and YouTube, so I'm happy to be able to multi-stream to those. But yeah, enjoyed hanging out with you guys, and I'm gonna record a vlog now, post it to our Patreon, and we're gonna get some new video content recorded and uploaded soon. I'm hoping to record sometime this week, although it's already shaping up to be a pretty busy week. So we'll see how that goes. But thank you so much for hanging out with me tonight. I really appreciate it. Thanks for all the love and support. Cal Magic pushing for the hype train. I appreciate that. And thank you so much for everybody who participated, interacted, all that good stuff. You guys are a great encouragement to me. Have a great week. And then we will hopefully see you sometime next week. Okay. Take care. God bless. Bye.